Welcome to the third episode of the Huntington Wiffle League podcast. I'm your host, Josh Smith, with my co-host,
Greg Sowers.
And our special guest co-host,
Jeremy Litton.
Jeremy Litton, former captain of the Wiffle Warriors, no longer in existence.
Thank God.
Okay, so we have two special guests, Patrick Rayl, Jacob Dunkle of the surging sleeper team, Pitch Slappers.
Hello.
Hello. Thanks for coming, guys.
Hey, thanks for having us.
Okay, we do have some questions for you.
So, guys, what's the roster situation for this upcoming season? Last year, you guys had six different guys show up. I've been to your practices. You've had four of the six show up to your practices.
Well, at the beginning of the year, we were actually had originated on Nick Capper starting with us, but he couldn't get out of work that day. Wade Napier and Chris Foltz actually showed up to be on a different team.
It's actually a team that I'm part of. This is Jacob speaking here.
Sorry. We're going to introduce you.
I guess that's later, so we'll just... I said that, and then I was like, well, I felt like I needed to define myself because I've never said anything yet.
Exactly the same thing.
Yeah.
I know it doesn't matter. I wasn't here last year, but I'm Zach, and I want to talk about this.
Yeah, a couple guys on our team, Wade Napier and Chris Foltz, were actually showing up to participate with myself in a softball practice the day the league started, and they just, actually the fields were all booked with softball teams, and so it was, they wanted to get in on wiffle ball, and we signed them up and added two guys to our team. And moving forward, I don't think Wade's going to be participating next year, but Chris Foltz, while he wasn't there for the recent practices, he, due to the softball that we still had going on, it was kind of, it was hard to, even for myself, to do both sports at the same time. It kind of,
Well, and he was driving from, South Point every Tuesday and Friday, and, he kind of had a drop off after the practices started, and, with Andy, the last game only had me, Andy, and Nick.
Right.
And it, Jake missed. He was out of town. And that was the game that I was like, man, we need Chris. Because he was our only consistent pitcher when Fall League was going on. So right now, I mean, our roster situation is going to stay the same. It's going to be me, Jake, Andy, Nick, and Chris. And I think we feel confident going in with five guys.
Okay. All right. Well, you still got room for one more on your roster, so... You got till April to do it. Don't necessarily need six people. We don't need a full-up roster. It's just sort of like a security thing just in case something happens. But, you know, a lot of teams, like Zach was telling us in the last podcast or brand, I can't remember. You know, the less people you have, the more
your
action
good players
they get
to
you know.
Play.
So you don't have to play the whole game of figuring out who's going to play when.
Right. Well, the way we've done it with our team is it's just all about who fields. You know, it's like whoever the pitcher's going to be, that's the most important position, right, on defense. So it's just like, you know, these two people play, or these three people play outfield, and then you just sort of rotate. Everyone bats, so.
The thing I'm looking forward to is if we can find two solid pitchers, that will help with the five-man rotation.
Yeah.
Because one of the pitchers will be sitting out during the games. So that way the next game when they're playing full innings,
fresh.
They're fresh, and we don't have to worry about.
And we are hopeful that our pitching has improved quite a bit from fall ball, just from two aspects. One, we've been doing it longer. We kind of started the season. Why has everybody got to laugh when I'm trying to? we started the season just kind of halfway, lobbing it in there, trying to get a strike, and it took us halfway through before we could start throwing the ball on the line. And we've now, it doesn't cost a whole lot. We did put together our own pitching square that we're now. Practicing on
smaller too, so if you hit that, you can True. Definitely hit our strike zone. Well, I think a place I'd like for us to get, I don't think it'll be next year, maybe 2015. A lot of leagues, they have rotation rules, like is mandatory. Yeah. You can only pitch this many innings, and then you must rest, because he and I were on different teams last year, and we've, you know, now we're on the Green Bears. We've sort of just sort of carried the team's responsibilities for pitching, whatever. So it's nice to have that, but in this regular season this past year, we didn't have that, because we're on different teams, and we were the team captains, and not really anybody else on either one of our team were actually reliable pitchers. And that weight that you carry is not just as a captain, leader of the team, and being in charge of everything, but that pressure on the mound, and there is nobody else that, there's no one that can come in and relieve you, there's no one that can come in and finish this and put it away. I mean, that kind of relief is something that's hard to come by. So if you've got that going on your team, you definitely have an advantage going into 2014.
Yeah, the rotation rule is something that's practiced at Nationals, which mm-hmm. gets a lot of teams because they don't have the depth at pitcher that they need.
Well, a lot of leagues are, it's not a unique problem, one that we have. It's just somebody on the team, they dominate, but and they could go all day because they do in their league, but that's not the rules at the tournament. And it's really not healthy. You're going to blow out your arm. You can ice all you want, stretch, be in good condition. But if Wiffle you're pitching...
Boy had that problem this past year.
Yeah, he actually tore his ACL.
Yeah. And there's going to be times when your control gets a little off, so you need somebody there to back you up.
Well, and that's why I think it was important for us to do these fall practices was every single one of us pitched, including Andy. And I don't say that mean, but... with me, Jake, and Nick all having, and Chris having baseball backgrounds, you know, we all pitched at some point in our lives.
Right.
Andy not having that baseball background, he's never pitched. But I think it's important because what killed us those last three games was we didn't have, I had to step up and pitch the whole time, not knowing if Andy or Nick could do it. And,
yeah.
You know, at that point, we were playing with three guys and we were really fatigued, and by the last game, I was done.
Now, those what-ifs will come up because we play, I don't know if we'll play 12 weeks, we may play 10, but it's a long season. You know, you're playing two games a night, so you'll be playing between 20 and 24 games. Anything can happen. And sometimes in the same week, just between one game and another, something get hurt, or they need to go, or they can't come. You know, lots of things can happen. So it's everyone who has the ability to pitch, you know, the more they practice, the more they can step up when the need arises. Okay, I want to talk about Jacob for a second. Jacob, as Nick did pretty well, but he played one less game. Andy, somehow, is really the only person that has 10 games played, and he played every single game.
He did.
Your team played?
The rough part was the NHL.
I was up close towards the top of the home run leaders, but I played significantly less than most others.
10 home runs, 18 RBIs, 600 batting average, 1.800 slugging. You didn't leave any players on base, because I keep track of that. You had 45 total bases, 18 RBIs, 2 walks, 4 strikeouts, 13 runs, 15 hits. It's pretty impressive. And I remember specifically when we played you guys, it was just like yard, yard, yard. And every time I was watching, you know, especially that last week, you guys were really lighting up bag tag from it. I really thought,
yeah. Hey. I was absent.
Well, that was Nick got that started. Mm-hmm. I think we had one out against us.
Yeah.
And Nick got that started.
You had quite the streak. I was impressed.
And Nick homered, then I homered, and I thought for sure the game was over at that point. Andy walked, and then Nick homered again. I homered, and then Andy hit a home run. The funniest thing was the first game, Andy hits a home run right before I step up to the plate. And I'm like, oh, no, that's not good.
Who's calling?
That's fine. Don't worry about it.
But, Andy hits a home run. I went, I really don't want to be behind Andy on home runs. So then I hit a home run. I'm like, I'm not behind you.
Who was pitching that game? Was that Zach or Paul?
Paul's pitching that game.
And that was before he found their entire team found Wiffle Ball in their life.
Yeah. Well, really? So far, unless they really pick up their pitching, offensively, I think they've got Maroon Squad bested in a sense, because Paul's just, like Brandon in his own words, just a super athletic guy. Brandon, he's very well versed in hitting now. I mean, he struggled during the regular season, but he's a new player now, and he's very confident now. He's got a team. He's, you know, got a very good,
feels confident.
Yeah, confident chemistry with it. He's playing with purpose now, and Kara's pretty good. I saw her hitting home run. Probably the best female player the league's ever seen.
Yeah, Kara has probably the best swing.
Mm-hmm. Stephanie. She
started out a lot hotter than Kara, but...
But...
she fell off in the end.
I can't come back from that. But I just mean, Stephanie, I think Kara even maybe pitched a little bit. I could see her pitching. Stephanie, she's just in a constant supportive role on defense, playing the outfield. I'd like to see her pitch. I mean, she is a team captain, but I'm so accustomed to seeing a team captain being a pitcher as well. So she stands out. In positive and negative ways as a captain. And she's hell-bent on coming back for next year. It may not be with the exact same team members, but they come back with the same team members plus a couple people. I still think they can make a run like they did earlier. But the first half of the season, I could see them being in the top three. So there's plenty of teams that, you know, you add a variable or take a variable away and things can happen.
There's a lot of wild cards next year. The Holy Bowl's roster was slightly shaky. If they straighten up a little bit, a lot of their shakiness came from they have real-life jobs, working at hospitals, firefighters, other things. We have no idea what they do.
Well, and going back to Bag Tag and what makes them a solid team is the fact that they take advantage of everything. I mean, they do. They will catch you on your heels 9 times out of 10 if you're not, you know, ready to play them. They're going to take advantage of it. They'll go for second without you even looking at them, and then they'll go for home if you try to throw them at second. They are aggressive.
They're opportunistic players, that's for sure. Like, and they're not dicks about it. I mean, they're highly competitive.
They're very cohesive as well. They play well together. They know they expect the next person to be going if the ball's flying around or still on the ground. They don't have to hesitate and make sure the person at second's going to third. They already know they're going.
Yeah, it's all very fluid and natural.
Well, they talk to each other a lot out in the field. They know right. Where each other is, and I think that was. There was one game in our season that we had complete breakdown of communication.
Right. Everybody, most teams have that,
and you know we'd have somebody not covering second. We'd have somebody calling for the ball, not going for the ball. Mm. And, yeah, I think that was the one thing that I really wanted us to work on. You know, that was one of our two weaknesses this year, in my opinion, was our communication out there and consistency. Consistency at the plate. We'd go from one game, no matter who was pitching, we'd light them up to the next game, couldn't hit anything. And that killed us.
Another thing I noticed about Bag Tag, as far as maybe some of the elements to their key to their successes, they always tweak everything. Most teams, they just like, screw it. And then they just stick with a batting lineup, whether or not it works. You know, it's little, you know, changes like that, sabermetrics, the small stuff, can really affect the outcome of the game. And they always change the batting order. They found a good combo and it worked for a while, then they worked something else. Sometimes somebody would play left field, sometimes they play right field.
I heard they picked up Jonah Hill, so might be.
So, I mean,
he's gonna get that movie reference.
Yeah, Moneyball.
I don't think I do.
Moneyball.
Moneyball?
Yeah.
I don't remember what I said before he
performed. Saber Matrix.
Oh, yeah. I like that movie. I saw it. I haven't seen it like fully awake. I only watched it on FX like at 2 a.m. one time.
I've never seen it.
It's pretty good.
It's a good movie.
Pretty good. It's not like action.
Still on Netflix?
I don't think it's on Netflix. It's all on FX like at 2 a.m. Yeah.
Nothing's on
it
has Netflix.
Has the movies.
That's not true. Power Rangers is on Netflix.
Good stuff there.
Don't even fucking talk to me about Netflix until you see Breaking Bad.
I'm not doing it.
Awesome show. Best show ever.
Arrow is pretty good.
We've been to watch Supernatural. I'm not ashamed.
I'm sorry.
I'm not ashamed.
Arrow is pretty good.
I will say that the first practice we played Bag Tag, we beat them.
Yeah.
We did beat them in our first practice.
I was there.
But they didn't have Kara, so.
I think you had Hobo Mojo. You had that home with the drunk guy watching you guys from afar.
Oh, that was a different game.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the following week.
I think we need some Hobo Mojo. That's because I really enjoy saying that.
By the way, if you're
playing, we used to have Hobo Mojo in Oregon. Crazy Dan.
Oh yeah. Was that the last week where you were there? that guy with the aluminum cans at night was going,
oh, Lord.
I missed that one.
I thought we were all going to get mugged.
That must have been Zach instead of you, because they were wearing glasses. I remember because like, the light was shining off of the lenses.
So. Yeah, because we were all kind of like, eh, well.
I was just trying
broke
to
up our conversation.
Look
we're
at something to look at that wasn't him, and that was mainly what it was.
We didn't start getting crowds, though.
The people were coming. Stephanie was bringing some people.
There were a few people. There was one lady who, while we were cleaning up one night, she was just asking me how all this got put together and everything else. And I don't even know if she was there with anybody or what. She just started watching the games.
Well, the Pink Penguins, they bring their family. They brought when they made the playoffs. they stood a chance. They were contenders. Thelmer, Team Captain, he brought his kid.
They had shirts and wife. Signs.
Yeah, they got uniform shirts at the beginning of the season. They were all about it. They made signs. And then the Holy Balls, they had their sort of like fan club to come out, like a handful of people, 5-6 people that came. I mean,
Maroon
I could see
us
having 25 people coming out just as spectators. It is entertaining to watch. I love watching games when we have a downtime and around. If we're playing at 5:30 and then we have a 7:30 game coming up, I love sitting around watching games. I mean, it's stressful when people are like, hit me. But, you know, I don't know what this means. But when that's not happening, I'm just watching like four games happen all the time. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Daryl talked about coming back in a spectator sort of thing next season. He wasn't sure if he was going to play.
I hope he stays involved somehow. How about, why don't you tell me where you came up with the team name? I know it's probably not a deep and meaningful story, like... You had a dream about it as a child, and, you know, whatever.
But. Maybe he did, Josh. You never know. Yeah. I think it's like you and the Green Bears. Yeah. I'm sure that you woke up in the middle of the night and said, I've got a team name, the Green Bears!
You know how we came up with that name? Nobody else on my team, it was like 12 years ago, and it was two girls. No one else, and me. I'm not one of the girls. They didn't want to pick a name, so I was like, fine, favorite animal, bear, favorite color, green. It's like Green Bears, here we go.
But, and when you signed that free agent that year, who was it?
No, that was you. I forgot about that.
How did that work out for you?
I mean,
sucked for terrible.
We actually had, what was it, three names?
Yeah, we had several. It isn't a very special story, to be honest, because really... we started out brainstorming, but then really it was just searching online for funny wiffle ball names, wiffle ball team names, and we ended up stumbling upon Pitch Slappers. Originally, the first one I threw out that was pretty interesting and unique, but I don't know that it would have fit, was Wee Willie Wiffle.
Yeah. We also, I like that. We also came within a second of picking Master Batters.
Oh. Tell me in 2014 you're going to make a Wee Willie Wiffle throwback jersey or something. I want a Wee Willie Wiffle for...
Come on.
We might actually go with it at some point.
That'd be funny.
But where we played in the kickball league, you know, there's some unique names in the kickball league, so we knew he had to come up with a unique name. And that's, you know, we took a vote. It was a vote between me, Jake, and Andy. I asked Nick, and then I ignored his thought process behind it. And we went with Pitch Slappers, which then led to a fun email session with you on trying to find the logo.
Oh, God.
We still made...
How many logos did I make? I made like 10 choices for you.
I'm pretty sure it was only like... six.
Whatever. Oh, well, there was some I didn't send to you.
Oh, okay.
After you spend a lot of time on it, I feel kind of bad saying this, but we were considering, you know, spending some time and making something interesting or different.
Oh, that's fine. It's just I wanted to get something on the website as soon as possible. Right. So people would know that, hey, this team exists.
I love it.
Because hearing that name, they're like, that's not his name.
It's almost offensive.
See, when people see a logo, they're like, ooh, yeah.
Well, the funny thing is that he was trying to come up with logo while we were emailing back and forth. So he went onto a forum/message board, and they started making fun of him because of Pitch Slappers being the name.
Yeah.
And they were talking about how serious you were taking it or something. I was like, it's a wiffle ball. It's not,
and then somebody said, serious. Yeah, darn you, Jake, for naming your wiffle ball team a witty name.
It was awful because I was just trying to find, from my end, trying to... to get a logo to match your desire there. It was hard to find something like a stock image or something that wasn't like domestic battery or someone crying or something.
We've actually considered the thought of having known domestic battery males last names or something along those lines.
Like, I have Ocho Cinco, Brown,
Randy Moss,
Varlamov. I mean, we're just going to go down the list.
Probably my favorite one I made that you rejected, which is for the best, was the one where I found the handprint.
Yeah.
And I made it maroon, which kind of looked like red, because I was like, maroon and black, that's a good color combo for this. Because, you know, like, bloody and bruised, but...
right.
But...
next, taking it to the next level.
That's right. I was like, we got deep. So, and it was just like this handprint, and I put, like, the, you know, sort of like a gradient of the ball, and I was like, pitch slapper.
Oh, you know, I know the secondary logo. It's get beat. Slappers get beat.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
I did that a lot last year.
Well, it's nice to know that the name Pitch Slappers comes from a deep, meaningful place in your heart. It's good to know.
It's good to know you didn't just Google it. No.
I'll tell you what, the kickball leagues did not disappoint with the insinuating team names. We got the Master Batters, Bag Tag, Pitch Slappers, Master Batters. Go Jackie Go, that was kind of a letdown, but you know.
It's still an interesting story behind it.
So. That was one less penis-related logo I had to make, so I appreciated that. I was like, oh, it's based off a dog. Oh, I can do that. I can make a logo for that. So, for me, that was a relief. But
I was upset when I saw another Master Batters. I was like, man.
Logo for that one, I wish I there was a better one. If anybody wants to make one for that, that'd be fine. But if there's any more kickball people who are getting involved, I can only imagine the team names that are going to be coming in. Or anybody that's just outside of the fold, as we know.
We had to retire the Yellow Beaver Fever.
Mm. I actually had students ask me about that name. They looked on the website, and they're like, Beaver Fever?
Uh-huh.
Yellow Beaver Fever? What does that mean? I'm like, go on Urban Dictionary.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, it's on there.
Don't go there. That we just came up with that just because it rhymed at first. And yeah. It was just some exhibition game.
Well, that was the second reason, was that before we started playing, we had looked at the website and saw team names, and I was like, oh, Green Bears.
Well, what are
some... it's like the fear, you know, like
well, then you get down the list, and you had the Welfare Warriors, which had a great logo, and then you kept going down. It was a creative logo. I'm not saying my political side.
Let me show you the secondary logo I made. You tell me. You fucking tell me which one's better. What are some of the team names that you did like? Like, other than Green Bears, because that's totally lame.
I like the Maroon Squad logo. The name, I didn't really get too much.
They got that name playing... basketball?
Well, their school colors are maroon, and people just started, I guess from what they told me, referring them as the squad, and then they're like, well, they're maroon squad.
Trying to think of the other teams that were listening.
The Holy Balls, yeah, they came up with theirs basically by certain, they had two different names. I believe one of them was the Master Batters as well. And theirs was actually picked.
Yes, it does. If you go to a website, it's called Wiffle Logos, blogspot.com. There's a guy that he's from Michigan. I know him. He's assembled a database of just all Wiffle logos from all different Wiffle leagues, and they are pretty amazing.
Actually, my favorite logo is made by Josh for the original Fat Bastards team.
We should have won Logo of the Year.
We did win one from Neapolitan Creamers.
That's because I used the strawberry, chocolate, and vanilla background.
Yeah. I did like
this. This is the logo I made for that, like the Hope. Thing with a wiffle ball instead. Is that the one you're talking
about? Yeah, that was the one I was talking about.
Oh.
Which one? What's the other one?
It's got President Obama doing this and sort of like shrugging.
Oh, no, I like that. I like the Hope.
With wiffle balls in each hand.
I saw that one now. I know which one you're talking about.
I don't remember. If I'm on the PC, I can find that image, but I don't have it on here. I don't do the cloud. But
well, the cloud is evil. Don't trust it.
Otherwise, I could whip it up.
You could get lost there.
But anyway... team names and stuff like it's just a nice little comical aspect that makes you can tell a lot about team by their team name and their logo. With not as much with our logo, with the logo, because I'm typically the person that makes the logo.
That's the reason why none of our girlfriends have showed up for games.
Right. My wife came once and was like, "That's too many people. I can't
do it. I don't know any of these kids, people." So yeah. That's my excuse for everything. But
your autobiography.
True. Yeah.
Four kids.
Now, in the previous podcast, I can't remember where you ranked us, but we were at the bottom half of the league.
You were next to last.
Yeah. That was before practice.
I still gave you the benefit of the doubt. I have always thought he defended us.
I always thought
you were a sleeper team. I still think that. I think Nick and myself
were towards the top in slugging percentage.
Yeah, I referred to you as a possible breakthrough team in that podcast. I had you
at the bottom because of your pitching at the time. That was before Nick stepped on the mound. Your pitching had improved drastically in the practice.
This was the week right after fall ball then when we recorded that.
I listened to the power rankings. I went, you know, I think Greg's going to rank us, you know, up there, probably middle of the pack team. And then
he ripped your arm out.
I was like, wow, he came up really early. Mm. Wow, that is...
It's motivation. It's motivation.
You weren't going, Jack, you go.
I guess that's
proof positive. Everybody needs to go out and make their own pitching square.
I'd say...
Is that the proper term for that, by the way?
We just refer to it as a strike zone.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. How many teams are we looking at in the league?
For next year, if everyone from the remains of the regular season, because we are two teams contracting into one, his team is gone. Holy Balls, at least Holy Balls, Pink Penguins, and...
you've got Nick.
Maroon Squad.
And Maroon Squad, plus the seven teams from Fall Ball. 12
with the team from Charleston.
And then Brandon's talking about there might be a second back tag related team. So if we get 12 teams, that would be awesome, because that would make a playoff bracket much more workable.
Hot Dogs also return.
Oh, yes. They're among the seven.
Okay,
that I mentioned from Fall Ball. So
with 12 teams, I'll give you 12. No. We will not finish below six.
No.
Will not. A disappointing finish for me would be anything below third place.
We're reaching a level of where I can start seeing considerable parity starting to develop between teams, where they're almost evenly matched. We thought we had that in Fall Ball with teams like Master Batters and Green Bears, but in the end, there was like a clear better team. And then, you know, with the bag tag and Wiffle Ballers, it was sort of give and take. But then, you know, I really think the Honey Badgers are really surging there for a while. And consider all the, I know I talked this up in the last podcast, but like, considering the surge they had, they went from 0-3 and then went on a seven game winning streak. That's longer than anybody else had. That's second only to Maroon Squad in the regular season. So, and considering that three out of their five players have significant knee problems, and two of their people were brand new and not from a kickball league and don't really, as far as I know, have a lot of athletic experience otherwise, did that well.
They didn't play a good team in us, though. In all honesty, we lost to them 1-0, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that was without me there. No. I stayed home to play NHL. Don't regret the decision, but I feel with me there we would have won.
Well, on the topic of the Honey Badgers, my prediction for the season is 5th out of 12. Why so low? The knee problems. And then Josh,
I don't think 5's low.
And then Josh and Ariel will start fighting and break up and leave.
The issue
you have to look into, and I didn't think about that when I say 6, you know, as the bottom line number that I would accept out of this team that we have. But depending on the divisions, you know, who you get stuck. I mean, because it'd be rough if we're in Maroon Squad bag tag.
I like it. It's all going to fall to chance. Yeah, we're going to draw names out of a hat.
I'm perfectly fine with that.
End up is where you end.
But
there's no other fair way to do it.
Yeah, but even with those two teams in a division that we play in, I feel that 6th place would be accepted. You know,
after going to practice, I accept your 6th place as the lowest your team will fall.
Third place,
you'll make
the playoffs.
It's a reasonable.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
if we get 12 teams, we'll have to finally create a basement. Like, eight teams in the playoffs. That's it.
And is there going to be? It seems like 12 is getting up there. I mean, I don't know how many teams you can go up to before you start running into, you know, people not getting to play enough games. And this
right
and
around 20 is where the maximum most leagues will even allow to extend to before it just becomes too much.
Yeah, the Potomac League in D.C. has 20. They have had 20 consistently. But Chris, in the Wiffle Pantheon, you know, he can, I mean, the money and time and labor he puts into
that. You don't understand until you go to Nashville.
And then in the Hormone League in Twin Cities in Minnesota, they finally topped out 24 teams, which I didn't think was possible.
They are wiffle ball royalty, though.
But it's more like two leagues, because one's in the Hopkins metro area, and then the other one's in Eagan. So they really run sort of code independently as sort of like American League and National League. And then they have occasional interleague play and then playoffs between those two leagues.
I would love for us to get there.
That's what I wanted to start in Charleston and, you know, have a River Cities. But Charleston just is not... Huntington is just so much more youthful and active. And, like, that's Huntington, West Virginia. I mean, it's like, think about that statement. Charleston is so much more lethargic.
Lethargic, affluent, and I would even say just flat out broke and don't know what wiffle ball is.
Yeah, it's like play ball. I don't want to do that.
Well,
and your access to parks in Huntington is just limitless.
You have more college age people in Huntington.
Well, it's a central population too.
Yeah.
The population in Huntington's all located right there.
Right. And you have very dense metro areas that stretch into other states. So,
It could easily expand through word of mouth fairly quickly, and
that's how it did. Brandon alone, that one mouth, look what it did. I mean,
as simple as how many people were like me that read the paper. Right. They went, wow, and then you didn't get that second year going again.
And you only need four or five people, so it takes very little, just your own little group of friends at work or whoever. I mean, it's very easy to form a team.
Well, that's my pitch for wiffle ball, is you don't have to have 11
getting a softball team so much
just
harder.
For a team.
I mean, kickball, we're struggling. We want to start our own kickball league, and we're struggling with, you have to have four girls, but you have to have six on the roster in case, a couple of them don't show up.
So, get hurt.
Yeah, you start going down that list, and you're like, wow, this is, because you're looking at between 11 and 15.
Four girls playing in wiffle ball all together?
Women. We're almost going to get 10. When we get 10 females that play, I'm going to make power rankings of female players I've ever had.
Female actual players or
that
female...
That have ever played.
Ever played.
Mm-hmm.
So you're saying now's a good time for me to get a sex change so I can...
have dominate those ranks? Yes. I think you would be a solid 5 in the rankings.
A time for Gina Litton to come play ball. All right, well, thank you for your time. And... having the lengthy discussions and answering our questions. Patrick Rayl and Jacob Dunkle of the Pitch Slappers, thanks for coming by.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you. That's all that we have to discuss on this episode of the Huntington Wiffle League podcast. Next month, we sit down and talk to the one and only Carl Coffey, who will be swinging by West Virginia on his way to Virginia during Christmas. Carl Coffey is, of course, the current commissioner of Wiffle in Southeast Michigan, and we base much of what we do with our league on things that he has done successfully with his league. So we follow the league very closely. It should be a very interesting and insightful interview, so don't miss it. In January, Josh Berletich will be coming to the studio, and we'll be talking to him regarding whether or not he does intend on returning for the 2014 season. He originally participated in the inaugural 2012 season with the league, then sort of just vanished, reappeared like the prodigal son in the 2013 fall ball season, and was playing the best ball of his career. So his team has also grown. So we're looking forward to perhaps him making and declaring a decision of whether or not he plans to bring the Honey Badgers back for the 2014 regular season. Then in February, we have just confirmed that Randy Steele and James Clagg of Maroon Squad will be in the studio sharing the mics with us, and that will surely be a very humorous podcast, so don't miss that one as well. If you're looking for more information and insight, articles, want to go ahead and register for the 2014 season, anything, watch videos, look at pictures, visit our website, which is just busting with content, at www.huntingtonwiffleball.com. Vote on our poll of whether or not we should go yellow bat in 2014 season. This, of course, will not have much influence over the decision overall, which will ultimately come down to the winter meeting, which you can also find information on about the website. But could be good to know. We'd like to gauge the interest in the issue. So visit our website at HuntingtonWiffleball.com. We're on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Just keep up. We'll talk to you soon.